Okay. Welcome, everyone. This is our monthly academic APP opportunity, and I want to introduce a couple of my colleagues here today. And I know we have a lot of students who have joined the call, a lot of people who are interested in pursuing nurse practitioner and or PA school, or just exploring opportunities in the trauma profession. So thank you all for joining us today. We're really excited to learn more about you, hear what questions you have, and share some of our experience and background. This career can be extremely rewarding and also extremely challenging. And so we're here to explore all of those different aspects with the expertise that's joined us today. So I'll start just by introducing myself, and then Jen, I'll hand it over to you. And I will also watch for Kelly to be joining the call as well. But my name is Katie Swenson. I'm the current chair of the APP Steering Committee for Pediatric Trauma Society. I am a PA by training, within the military a little bit ahead of healthcare. And so you'll hear a little bit more about my journey here momentarily. But I'm currently serving in a leadership capacity and practiced clinically in pediatric liver transplant. And I will pass it over to my colleague and co-chair, Jennifer York.
Hey, I am Jennifer York. I am a nurse practitioner at Arkansas Children's Hospital. We're a level one trauma center. I'm really excited to meet you guys today, and I really hope I can share my screen. Do you want me to just go ahead and start?
Kelly, why don't you do a quick intro, and then Jen, I'll just start off on my end and then pass to you, and then Kelly can wrap up, and then we'll take comments from those on the call and questions from those interested in joining trauma.
Perfect. Hi, all. Sorry for my lateness. I was having IT issues. So as Katie said, I am Kelly Wiseman. I am a neurosurgery physician assistant. I work at Akron Children's Hospital in Ohio. So happy to be with you guys today.
Awesome. Thanks, Kelly. And we really just did try to get a smattering of experience across different specialties, different clinical backgrounds, different professional backgrounds. So each of us has about a 10-minute or so presentation about our experience and career pathway. And then, as I mentioned, we'll open it to the audience to share any other insights or experiences that they have, and then take questions afterwards. So I'll go ahead and share my screen. Hopefully you all will be able to see it. And if someone could just let me know when you're able to see.
I can see it.
Okay. Awesome. Okay. Well, this is, as I mentioned, I am in a leadership position right now, so full-time administration, and this is the course that brought me to that point so far. So from military to medicine. A brief overview of my very early days. Grew up in Southern California. Had a smattering of involvement in sports and music and Girl Scouts, and ultimately wanted to differentiate myself in my professional work life, and decided to attend the United States Air Force Academy for my undergraduate training, which it's a military institution comparable to West Point or Annapolis, located in Colorado Springs, Colorado. So at that time, I knew I wanted to do pre-med. I was thinking pretty heavily about med school. And so studied biology with a pre-med emphasis and a minor in French. So a few characteristics or attributes, growing pains, if you will, along the way. Basically, what the military taught me is you really need to know yourself before you can be in a position to take care of others, whether that is in a leadership sense or a clinical capacity. And really knowing and understanding your personal limitations, your knowledge base, and how do you plan on navigating that? You know, what are your resources available? And really having that discretion, particularly in a clinical space where, you know, you graduate as a provider, an independent provider, but the experience side is lacking in that you haven't been able to see or do it all. And I don't know that you ever get a chance to do that in your career, but you certainly learn with each experience. So A couple of tools and resources that I have found helpful is really adopting a growth mindset, you know, being humble and knowing what those limitations are, and then knowing what resources and people that you can reach out to ask for help. Along that way, I found that in the military, you know, as an officer, my go-to people were my senior enlisted members that reported to me, but had years, if not decades, of experience in that discipline. And so were extremely valuable. In the clinical space, nursing has been a really big advocate and ally, particularly as new graduates. And so, you know, while there's definitely a hierarchy in terms of clinical scope of practice and expertise in terms of responsibility and clinical decision making, in that, and I'm an OR or a surgical PA by training, in that really who are my biggest points to ask questions or lend themselves to my success along the way. And of course, that mentality expands into a team-based care mentality. So really leaning on your surgery techs, your MAs, your nursing colleagues to help, you know, educate you and teach you the tricks of the trade along the way. So from the military, I was stationed overseas in England. I was in aircraft maintenance, so a non-healthcare related field. But again, knowing that I wanted to get into healthcare, that was an intentional decision to pursue leadership opportunities in the military as a young officer. So I was able to travel and get some life experience. That has significantly played a part in terms of my perspective in healthcare when it comes to social determinants of health, just being able to relate to people with different cultural background, different languages, different value structure sometimes, and just knowing how privileged we are in so many ways really adds that perspective and depth to my career. I thought I wanted to be a forensic pathologist. So while overseas, I studied in England at Anglia Ruskin University, located in Cambridge, and pursued a master of forensic science. And also at that time decided that I wanted to pursue the career track of a physician assistant as opposed to going to med school. So I attended A.T. Still University. And at this point in my career, really expanding my character building and professional skills to beyond just knowing myself, but now knowing my team, knowing my people and my tribe, if you will. So expanding to become not just self-aware, but more situationally aware, and adopting a more outward outlook, if you will. So thinking more broadly, as opposed to what is going to help me be successful and what skills do I need to develop to be personally successful and accountable and responsible, to more, how do I lead a team? Whether that was in the military, preparing for deployment downrange, or a clinical team. What does that look like in different clinical spaces? And a couple of resources I found along the way, just different inspirational leaders. I tend to lean or gravitate more towards academics. And so I'm constantly reading, you know, studying leadership, if you will. And so in that, there is no shortage of resource for those who aspire to be lifelong learners. So that is what ultimately brought me to Utah. My transition into PA practice after graduating from A.T. Still University. I enjoy most outdoor sports and activities, so skiing. I train in an athletic training facility alongside some professional snowboarders and people who do MMA, although I do not do either of those myself. But it's more the spirit of competition and challenge and just the camaraderie of having a team that is high performing to challenge you and push you to new limits. I practiced clinically in orthopedic surgery as my first job out of PA school, and that was at the University Orthopedic Center in sports medicine, hip and knee arthroscopy for both pediatrics and adults. But quickly realized I really loved the pediatric population. I loved trauma. And so ultimately that's what brought me to Primary Children's Hospital in Salt Lake City, Utah, which is part of Intermountain Health. the system, which now spans 7 states in the western region of our country, and have gotten pretty heavily involved in leadership opportunities here. I'm the current president of our UIPA chapter, and along the way, I also continue to foster my love for leadership and leading teams in general in the clinical setting. So completed my doctorate of medical sciences from the University of Lynchburg with an emphasis on clinical leadership. And in that, I had the opportunity to become adjunct faculty with the University of Utah. And the unique opportunity that that brought about is such that I'm the only APP who's actually faculty with the School of Medicine for the physician colleague. So I've been able to continue this work and through that opportunity, continue to deliver clinical leadership academic sessions to our pediatric fellows. Usually it's the first year fellows, sometimes second year peds fellows, but really work on focusing skill development, increased awareness, you know, teaching them how to be clinical leaders and really in that partner with APPs, but also how do they partner with multiple different types of caregivers? And how do they do that effectively given that they're physicians? What skills do they need uniquely as a physician that differentiates them in their position with the clinical responsibility that would speak to their role on that team? And then I also recently went back to school and completed my executive master's business administration degree through the University of Utah. And ironically, now partner with my senior medical director, who I also graduated from that program with. Which brings me to knowing your purpose and my current position as the executive clinical director of surgical specialties, digestive health clinical programs at Intermountain Healthcare, now Intermountain Health, and really stepping into this position, reaching beyond the clinical. This is now managing multiple surgical teams. So I have 13 divisions within my portfolio, all of the surgical specialties and gastroenterology. And the structure of that team is there's an associate medical director. So I mentioned I have a dyad partner with my senior medical director that you saw the picture of a moment ago. And we have associate medical directors, so one per division. You can think of them as a division chief, if you will. And then I have nursing direct reports. So I actually am also unique in this position in that there aren't any other APPs that have navigated quite this pathway where they have surgeon dotted line direct reports, nursing direct reports, no APPs in my portfolio except to partner with our APP directors. So knowing your purpose and continuing to expand on your skill set as you progress throughout your career is vitally important to being able to see opportunities for you to progress and grow, use your unique skill sets to better the lives of not just our patients, but our caregivers, your colleagues, your partners, and really understand, you know, what are the opportunities in different areas that you never thought were either possible or existed? So I don't have any specific resources about knowing your purpose. That's a really individual, very personal journey. But what I will say is that, you know, I'm an avid reader, and this is one book that I absolutely would put to you to as recommended reading is Man's Search for Meaning. Viktor Frankl is a survivor of the Holocaust who later became a psychologist. And in this, he talks about your purpose and understanding that sometimes it's not what you want to get out of life, but what life expects of you. And really, as I've progressed throughout my career, it is, you know, adopting a service orientation and that outward mentality of how do we better serve our patients? How do we better serve our teams? What skills do you need as a leader, as an administrator that helps you in your position? And while you may be at an executive level, it's not so much about telling people what to do or telling people how to do it, rather than developing them professionally and clinically and asking them provocative questions that get them thinking about how do they continue to grow and then be a part of the change that needs to happen within transplant, within ophthalmology, within robotics, and really leaning on them at their level, clinical, leadership, professional, or otherwise, to develop their teams and really leading through influence. So this is just a synopsis of kind of what I've covered and learned throughout my career. And you can see kind of the career progression as far as the specific positions that have related to my opportunity for learning and professional growth in each of those phases of my life, if you will. And it's a really good exercise that I also take our pediatric fellows through. And in the context of, think of yourself as, you know, medical student, think of yourself as a resident, think of yourself as a fellow, and then think about where you want to be as an attending. And in that, how are you different as a fellow than when you were as a medical student? How are you different as a fellow than you know, what you're expecting of your residents that you're now leading? And so you can really do this exercise no matter what phase of your life or career you're in, as long as you've had some pretty significant phases, stages, you know, life events that have really helped develop and formulate your character over time. So with that, you know, I will happily share my contact information with anyone and everyone here on the call. If you'd like to reach out, I'm always available through any one of these means. So I will hand the time now over to Jen, who will share a little bit about her background and experience. And Jen, are you able to get your slides working or?
I don't know. We'll see. Let me see. Okay. It told me I couldn't because you were, okay, now that you're done sharing yours, let's see if y'all can see my, can you see my slide?
Not yet.
Well, I can see it on my screen.
Did you pick the global vision? Like you can pick different screens?
I didn't. Now my screen is frozen and not responding. We may have to go to Kelly first. Let's see. Might kick me off. I'm clearly not a millennial. I cannot get around the computer. You may have to switch. My entire internet is, I think, about to freeze on me. So hold on. Like my screen is fuzzy from what I can see. Like what I can see of you is fuzzy.
You want me to go first, Katie?
Yeah, we might have just lost her, so let's give her a minute to transition and rejoin. And Kelly, yeah, if you're ready, just go for it.
Yeah, no problem.
All right, we can see.
Perfect. Still working?
All right. Yep, we've got you in presentation mode. Looks great.
Perfect. All right, everyone. Well, thank you to you all for joining us today. So as I said before, my name is Kelly Wiseman. I am a neurosurgery PA that works at Akron Children's Hospital in Ohio. So a little bit of background kind of about my career path. So I started thinking I wanted to be a kind of child and adolescent sports related physical therapist. I played volleyball all throughout my life, really loved working with kids and teens. So went to the University of Mount Union for undergrad, small liberal arts school in Ohio to pursue pre-PT. And I started majoring exercise science and shortly realized that I didn't really care how to make my athletes run faster or about their specific nutrition for their gameplay and those sorts of things. So I changed to biology and kind of started to explore a variety of healthcare careers, knowing that I really was still interested in focusing in pediatrics. So I did a lot of sort of exploration, silly things like Googling different careers, doing shadowing, asking to meet with people over, you know, coffee and talk about why they're in the career that they are. And I realized that I wanted a career with some level of autonomy. So one of the other things I looked at was child life specialist, which if you haven't heard of that career, it's a really awesome career we have in pediatrics. They are trained about sort of the social, emotional, and cognitive development of children and teens. And so they help relay messages about different medical procedures. They do non-pharmacologic coping for our kiddos. And so they're a really big part of our healthcare team.
So while they're wonderful, I realized that I wanted to be able to make more decisions than our child life specialists are able to do. And so kind of with all of that self-exploration, I realized that a career as a PA was really what I wanted to do. Some additional things I did in my undergrad career that really helped me kind of develop into the person that I am. So I did a ton of volunteering and was very involved on my campus. I was one of those people who didn't know how to say no. And so I think I grew a little bit towards the end of my college career to realize there are some limitations to your time. And then I also had the pleasure of doing a summer undergraduate clinical research program here at Akron Children's Hospital called the SPURS program, which was kind of my first taste of clinical research, which I really enjoyed. I went to PA school for my master's degree at the University of Toledo at the very top of Ohio, almost in Ann Arbor. Kind of funny because everyone thinks that they're in Michigan, like they watch Michigan sports. So it was a little funny being kind of from Northeast Ohio where everyone's focused on Cleveland. So I did go to PA school directly from undergrad, which is becoming more and more challenging now because of the healthcare hours that are required. I really chose Toledo for a number of reasons, but I loved that we were part of the College of Medicine campus. And so we had required coursework and opportunities with the College of Pharmacy and the College of Medicine. So I really liked that kind of multidisciplinary learning. I would describe my kind of PA experience as work hard, play hard. And what I meant by that is it definitely was a challenging time education-wise and did take a lot of effort. But I had a phenomenal class. There were 40 students and we were all incredibly close. And so it's really a time of my life that brings me a huge amount of joy. I would say about grad school, it's really important to pick a program that matches your needs. So unlike Katie alluded to about her, you know, extracurricular activities with training now, I don't love super competitive environments. And so it was really important to me to have more of that kind of family or team approach, right? Being able to ask a classmate, you know, if they have a different way of approaching studying for this course or things like that. I tried to maximize my pediatric exposure because I knew that was what I was interested in. And I continued with volunteering. So I was able to participate in a free medical clinic in undergrad, which let me sort of gave me exposure to the clinical setting of medicine while I was still in my didactic education. And I also was elected to be the student representative for AAPA. So it meant that I got to go as kind of my college's PA representative to the national conference, which was in DC that year. These are just a couple of fun pictures. Love peds, right? So of course I would be dressing up for Halloween at the free medical clinic. This is a picture of a bunch of Christmas gifts. My class kindly supported my interest of trying to adopt a family for the holidays and just did incredible work. And this is a recent example of someone in my class who just got married a couple of months ago. And some classmates and a classmate's wife, because we were all about supporting everyone's whole family, spouses, kids, all of that. So I did a fellowship program after PA school. So I, about 6 months before graduation, looked for jobs and found this fellowship program through Texas Children's Hospital. And it was the perfect idea of what I wanted to do. It was a great fit for what I was looking for. So I applied and was thankfully interviewed and accepted for the fellowship program. So I graduated on December, I think, 17th, and 30 days later was my start date for my fellowship program. So in 30 days, I studied, passed my boards, got a Texas license, and moved across the country. And yes, I moved without knowing if I passed my boards. So it was very stressful. But it was an incredible experience. So it was a surgical fellowship. So we rotated through all of the variety of surgical specialties at the Children's Hospital. And it was a great, great, great experience. You know, the purpose of the fellowship was really your education, right? So we were there not to be a scribe, not to be an extra body. We were there for advanced training and education. And that's so, so, so important if you're interested in doing a fellowship program that you really know the why of why you're there. We got to have really unique experiences. I saw some fetal cases, which were really cool that I got to scrub in on. One of the pictures I have here is with Dr. Jennifer Arnold, so from the Little People. So at that time, she has since left, but she was the simulation director at Texas Children's And so we were invited to participate in a simulation experience with some of the CVICU fellows. And so kind of takeaways from my fellowship experience, I really learned how to be a provider and how to be a medical professional. If any of you have ever been to the Texas Medical Center, it is like a whole different world. There are multiple hospitals that are huge. It's like a Texas Medical Center, it's like its own city. And so it's an incredible experience, just the amount of education and knowledge and kind of fully embracing that environment was so, so special. And I also got to see, because I rotated through all of the surgical specialties, I got to see a variety of different roles that PAs played within that team dynamic, right? With other learners, fellows, residents, medical students, PA or NP learners, and then the attending physicians. And so it was really a great exposure to kind of a variety of different structures of careers. So I am currently a neurosurgery PA. Like I said, I work at Akron Children's Hospital. So about 35 miles south of Cleveland, Ohio. We are a tertiary level one pediatric trauma center, ATS verified as level one last fall. I think one of my trauma friends is here. So very excited we got our level one designation. As a neurosurge PA, we do not have any learners on our team. So we do not have any residents that cover our service or fellows. So the benefit of that is the PAs and the surgeons, we kind of get to do all of it. So I do inpatient care, outpatient clinic, first assist in the operating room, and also have some credentialed procedures that I can do independently as well. We do take primary call for our service. So that means parent calls overnight, consults from the hospital, consults from the ER come to us first as PAs. And I have a little joke now every 4 days. So our cute little piggy in the photo is Emily. She's our newest team member. So we kindly stole her from our ICU. So we're super glad to have another member of our team. Means a little bit less work, which is awesome. Things I love about my job. I love that every day is different. And that sometimes it can be a little bit like running around with a chicken with your head cut off. I like the chaos and sometimes the high acuity decision making. I love that I get to see kiddos in the hospital for acute situations, right, like trauma. But then also that we have some patients we follow for their whole life. So kiddos that we meet prenatally with spina bifida, or that we follow from the NICU, or our brain tumor kiddos that we follow for long periods of time. So having that relationship with families, I also like as well. Obviously, I love pediatric trauma, and I'm very thankful that my APPs and our trauma surgeons here are so willing of my participation in our trauma committee here and doing some research with trauma as well. And then I have a really great relationship structure with our surgeons that we work with. And so I call it a know what you don't know mentality. And really what that means is, you know, they give us a lot of autonomy in our own decision making, with the expectation that if we are unsure or we have a question, we will ask. And so it's a really good working relationship. So this is my fun slide. I was inspired because Katie had so many cute little pictures and in little diagrams. And so these are some of the things that bring me joy in my professional practice. So this photo here, which includes Jen and Katie, I figured since you guys didn't have it in your PowerPoint, I would use it. So this was after the PTS meeting in November. The APP group went out to get some dinner and just network. This is two of my colleagues that I've met through PTS in the 2021 conference. We did an injury prevention lecture. So I'm the past chair of the Injury Prevention Committee for PTS. So it's been a great experience to meet lots of people from around the country. One of my passions kind of since undergrad has been working and volunteering with Serious Fund Children's Network. So it was founded by Paul Newman, and they're free camps for kids with medical complexities. So it's nice to kind of step away from the hospital environment and volunteer as a camp counselor, not med staff. So this is Lynn, one of the nurses that I met during my time volunteering in that organization. And then SPERS. So I mentioned that I had the pleasure of doing this research program when I was an undergrad. And when I came back to this institution, I've been a co-director of this program. So I really love to work with young students, undergrad students who are interested in a variety of healthcare careers and really finding their passion. So that's a lot of fun as well. And then you'll see a cute little trauma man. Those were some voodoo donuts from our Portland conference. And then the little tweet is something that I've also had the pleasure to do with the Pediatric Trauma Society. So I am one of two representatives for PTS through the Trauma Prevention Coalition. And so this is a group of representatives from lots of trauma and surgical organizations, as well as injury prevention nonprofits, really is a way to kind of stay connected between the peds world, adult world, and talk about injury prevention and trauma care. So my take-home advice, lessons learned, kind of life perspectives. So take opportunities. You know, it can be something as small as when you're learning, you know, are you willing to stay late or do something extra to see an interesting case or learn from a patient or learn from a mentor? Don't be afraid to make connections. You know, one of the benefits of the Pediatric Trauma Society and what has really brought me a lot of joy in the last 3 years is just the people that I've made connections with all over the country in a variety of roles. And you know, when you get into your professional career, you have opportunities to be involved in organizations and make connections. So take advantage of those opportunities. And then find your passion, right? So Katie's, you know, enjoys academic medicine and having those additional tools that she has, you know, worked for and developed to help learn how to foster and develop other people's skills. What are you passionate about? How can you supplement that into your career? Find your work-life balance. So in pediatric trauma and, you know, neurosurgery, not everything we do every day is sunshine and daisies and unicorns. We like to think it is in peds, but sometimes there's really, really crappy days and bad outcomes. And so have your team that you go to, find your, you know, self-reflection time and things you can do to take a little bit of break. And then find people in your workspace who continue to inspire you. So I've been lucky to have some great mentors through PTS and through my institution that has really challenged me and pushed me to continue to grow as a professional. So that's my little spiel. Like Katie said, feel free to also jot down my contact information. More than welcome to reach out to me as well. Thank you.
Kelly, that was amazing. I feel so inspired and fortunate to be a member of PTS alongside you. And we got Jen's slides up and running. So
I'm gonna let Katie share them because last time my computer crashed completely and I got kicked out of Zoom.
No, I think, you know, Kelly had some really impressive points. And I think one of the things that I do appreciate most about this group in particular is the opportunity to learn from one another. And you're never too experienced to learn. So there's always something out there through your network, through your friend circle, through your professional circle. So thank you, Kelly and Jen. I'm looking forward to hearing your talk here too. Let me get your slides up for you.
We can find it. No, I think it's great too. And you know what I love about this group is, like, you know, you really like the leadership aspect. Kelly does neurosurgery. I love the variety of what we do because it takes the village to take care of a trauma patient. Okay. So as I said, I'm Jennifer York. I'm one of the nurse practitioners at Arkansas Children's Hospital. We have three nurse practitioners that are inpatient. We are interviewing next week for a fourth, and we work general surgery and trauma. We all just kind of share the work. So we kind of get to do a little bit of all of the things. So I'm going to tell you a little bit how you get here with nurse practitioner. I don't even know if I gave you the right slides, but we're going to roll with it. So to be a nurse practitioner, it's very different than the PA route. You go through your bachelor's of nursing and then you go on, you work, I think it's 2000 clinical hours, or maybe now they're letting you go straight back to school. And then you can go through the MSN program or the DNP program. What I highlighted here that's really important, these are the UAMS programs that they have. Your state, every state is different. In the state of Arkansas, you must be acute care to work in the hospital and to work trauma. So if trauma or inpatient care is a direction that you want to go, it's really important that you choose the adult acute nurse practitioner, the adult or the peds nurse practitioner acute care program. Just make sure you choose acute care or find out from your state board what that looks like, because it's different in every state. In Arkansas, you must be acute care. We had some team members find out that the wrong way. So I have spent almost my entire career, minus about a year, between UAMS and Arkansas Children's Hospital. UAMS is where I went to undergraduate nursing program and where I got my master's, and I work at Arkansas Children's Hospital, which is that beautiful hospital you see right there on your right. I started my career in nursing in 2003. I was a hem-onc nurse, pediatric hem-onc nurse. I graduated with my master's in 2015. I worked in the emergency department for 2.5 years, and then I transferred to the surgery and trauma service, and I have been here since, and they're stuck with me now because I love my job. Oh man, this, I totally sent you the wrong PowerPoint. Man. Okay, so we're going to go real backwards, and I don't even know what's on here. I hope you at least get the good pictures on there. So first I'm going to tell you a little bit kind of about what I do, because you don't have the right slides. What we do every day as nurse practitioners at Children's Hospital, there are three of us. We manage all the trauma patients. From the time a trauma comes into the trauma bay, we can help run the traumas. We assist our surgeons and our fellows in any kind of procedures that they need. We can help make the decision on what imaging is needed, what labs are needed. We have a lot of authority in the trauma bay, which is really great. We follow the patients if they need to go to the CT scanner, if they need to go to the OR, we help facilitate that and we go with them. When they transfer to the floor, to the ICU, we will go with them to the ICU. Our patients, once they get admitted, we follow them from the time they're admitted to the discharge. The nurse practitioner team is responsible for rounding daily on our trauma patients. We round with just our trauma surgeon. We are a teaching hospital, so we have interns, residents, fellows. They will all round through, but the care of the patients, of the trauma patients, is mostly up to the trauma surgeons and the nurse practitioners at our hospital. We collaborate with ENT, orthopedics, neurosurgery, plastics, you know, any of the subspecialties. We're kind of like, I like to describe to families, we're like the air traffic control of a trauma patient. And we kind of manage it all and then kind of disperse as needed. We also see patients in our trauma clinic in the outpatient setting, which is really cool. We we're really working on some mental health stuff and really kind of getting some research projects going on, really making sure that these patients don't have acute stress afterwards and then we're not slipping through the cracks. Another thing that we're responsible for is a lot of process improvement and quality assurance projects, which is really fun, and getting to get involved in more trauma research, which is pretty cool. Because we are the front lines. We're the ones who see those patients every day. And so we're the ones who can take that information back to the trauma department. So some clinical pearls for me, if you think that trauma, any aspect of trauma, is something that you want to do, whether it be neurosurgery, ENT, maybe you want to do a subspecialty, maybe you don't want to do just trauma, is if you have the opportunity to spend extra time in clinicals with those surgical subspecialties, do it. You can really see what you like and what you don't like and what interests you. It makes you, what makes you want to go to work every day. And then it kind of gets your foot in the door. You kind of, you do your clinicals and you say, I kind of like this. And you, they have your name and they know who you are. And you come in a situation like us, we're going to interview and 1 to 2 weeks for a new nurse practitioner. And we have people, they've all come and done clinicals with us, which is great. Reach out to your preceptors and see how you can be more involved. And don't be afraid to ask questions and don't be afraid to say, hey, can I go watch that? Can I go see that? Don't be afraid to do it. Like, I know as a student, you feel like you are the most useless person in the room, but you are there to learn and they want to teach. We want to teach. I know everyone on this panel does. And we love to teach students. We were in your shoes one day. We know what it's like to feel like you are lost and you're in the way. And so we want to really empower you to seek out those learning opportunities and know it's okay to ask. And if the time's not right, the person will say, hey, no, the time's not right. But you have just as much right to be in those rooms as everyone else. The other thing is really like join your local and national organizations. For me, it's the trauma organizations because trauma is my passion, but join your local nursing or PA networks, join Pediatric Trauma Society. Really get in and network. You can do it even as a student. I know it seems crazy, but get your foot in the door then, and then you'll have so much more opportunity going forward. I hope I got my good pictures in here. Oh, I did. There are some pictures. Okay. So the picture on the left of the three, that's myself and Jordan and Mallory. Mallory was pregnant with her baby, who is now one at the time. I emailed them today and I was like, we need to take new pictures. These are our three inpatient nurse practitioners. The picture on the right, that's part of our pediatric surgery team. We have a lot of fun. You know, what we do is not always easy. What we see is not always easy. So it's really important to work with people who wear colorful wigs on their heads. And because you have to, it's really important to find a job that you're passionate about and that you love the people you work with. The girl on the far right with the unicorn is our trauma medical director, Dr. Wyrick. She was on call one day and we sent this page. Some of the ER nurses and I sent this page to her, just to her. It went out as a trauma page and she comes down to the ER. She was like, what is happening? And one of the ER team leaders was on, this is our trauma bay on the left, was on a trauma stretcher in a full on unicorn costume. And it was the most amazing thing. So just have fun with what you do. You have to. And then the last slide, is there one more? This is why you should join PTS, because we love PTS. This is the past 2 years of conferences. There's gonna be a slide at the end, I think, that will show you how you can join if you want to. I went to Baltimore last year. We just went to Portland. I got to go hiking. You know, our trauma medical director is one of my best friends. It's so fun to be able to travel and do things. We went hiking. That picture on the bottom right, those are some big time pediatric trauma surgeons. And we're all like stuck on an elevator together. It's just really cool. You get to network. And that picture in the bottom, you can see, this is just what our APP committee did last year. It's really cool to see these accomplishments that we can go in front of this entire pediatric trauma society. And we can say, look what the APPs are doing. And so I think that was really important to show you guys. I think that's all I've got. The next slide is just maybe my information or it might be gone. Yeah. Sorry, I have a new computer and it saves things in two different ways.
I also got about 3 or 4 different emails from you all at once. And so I might have
Okay, I just wanted it to have the good pictures. That's all I care about is the pictures. I can win all the rest.
I don't know if, you know, that was not the presentation you were planning on using. I thought that was outstanding. And I'm just, you know, this is such a fulfilling part of my day, is to be able to sit, you know, among colleagues and hear your background and learn more about you and just all the ways that you enrich your clinical practice, but then also our Pediatric Trauma Society network. So thank you for being willing to share your experience and your background today with those on the call. I also wanted to just briefly introduce Brandy Farrell and Liz Weibel. So Brandy is our immediate past chair and taught me everything I know about Pediatric Trauma Society and really encouraged me to get involved. And so in that, she is part of my leadership legacy and one of my healthcare heroes. And Liz Weibel also has been a longstanding member of the PTS leadership team, also having held the position of co-chair, chair, past chair, committee leads. And I just wanted to give both of them the opportunity to share a little bit about their background, where they practice, and if they have pearls of wisdom as well. So Liz, I see you. Why don't you go first?
I sure will. Thank you so much, Katie and Jennifer and Kelly. Tremendous presentations. You're so inspirational. You guys are just so wonderful. And folks have so much to learn, so many opportunities. So my name is Liz Weibel, as Katie mentioned. I am a trauma nurse practitioner here in Washington, D.C. I've been at Children's National Hospital for the majority of my career. And right now I actually have a role that is focused on performance improvement, quality improvement. So I work one day a week clinically, but for the last 4 years, I have taken over the role of the PI coordinator. So again, looking at individual patient cases and looking at the care, you know, really from arrival to ED through discharge and beyond, and really looking to see how we can improve the quality of care that we provide to our pediatric trauma patients. So love pediatric trauma, love pediatric burns. And I really want to share the importance of finding a mentor. With that, I'm going to pass the mic, if you will, to Brandy Farrell. But Brandy, in my first nurse practitioner job, was my mentor. We have continued to be dear, dear friends. Our families are friends. And again, the work is hard. So make sure that you have someone you can confide in, someone you can really, you know, follow in their footsteps. So again, find a mentor. And if you're interested in joining, I know Kelly put the her email address in there, and you have email addresses for Katie and Jennifer as well. But we would love to have you as members of the Pediatric Trauma Society, and we can certainly give you an outline and overview of all the benefits that PTS can bring to you in your practice. Brandy.
It is good to participate in all of this. I'm Brandy Farrell. I live in San Antonio, Texas. I work for UT Health San Antonio. I am a faculty member for 70% of my role, and I work clinically in the pediatric ICU, which is our level one trauma center in all of South Texas. So I still do a lot of trauma. I previously was the trauma burn nurse practitioner with Liz. As she mentioned, and before that, emergency and child maltreatment. So I took care of a lot of trauma patients in the previous role. I've worked in a lot of different places, and I have had a lot of great experience as a nurse. I told my husband I could work anywhere, and he's decided to test that theory. So, and some life lessons that I've learned, or career advancement, is just be a lifelong learner. Be willing to open yourself up to being the novice again, because you may be in a different institution or a different role, and being willing and open to how different places function and who the experts are, that could really benefit you and your career. I would also reiterate what Liz said about having a mentor. That makes a huge difference when you can like phone a friend and say, hey, what do you think about this? Or, I need some help, either career advice or clinical advice. With that, if you're a member of PTS, you can be part of the APP listserv, and then you can phone lots of friends at one time and put out a clinical question and say, and get feedback from all over the country, from all different size programs, about how they handle a different situation. And then the last thing is, I agree with Jen York, absolutely join your local professional organizations. The National Association of Pediatric Nurse Practitioners is a great NP one. There are PAs. Join your state, your local state organizations for your professional group. And then also Pediatric Trauma Society East, all of those that serve our patient, that will give you great contacts and offer you great ability to ask questions of those of us who function in these roles all the time. So thank you for including me, Katie and Jen. You did a great job, and I will stop so people can ask questions.
Awesome. Thank you everyone for your comments and your presentations. We have about 10 minutes to take questions. And certainly if there are any other APPs on the call that would like to share any of their insight, we'll take those comments as well. I don't see anything coming through in the chat. So if you'd like to come off mute, just maybe a quick introduction, what your interest is, and then your question. This is a friendly group, so.
I am curious who on here, if you can even type it in, like who are nursing students, who are PA students? Where are you from? How'd you hear about us?
You read my mind.
Type it.
Yeah.
You can type it if you don't want to raise your hand.
All right, I'll ask a question if no one else will.
Yeah, go for it.
I'm Stacia Gafori. I am actually the Pediatric Trauma Program Manager at Dartmouth Hitchcock in Lebanon, New Hampshire, and I am in NP school myself. So I'm so grateful for you all. I've gotten to join a couple of your webinars and such through the APP network, and you all have been so helpful so far already. So I suppose my question is, if any of you have experience with dual kind of criteria. So I'm in, my program is primary care that I'm in right now, and I'm fully acknowledging that jumping right into a trauma role is not going to be on my radar. But if anyone has had the experience of getting both primary care and acute care certificates and what that looked like for you in your career trajectory.
I can take that, Katie, if you want.
Please.
I'm faculty and DMP prepared, but you know, I've been doing it more than a couple decades and we won't get into specifics, but when I first started as a nurse practitioner, you could only be primary care certified. Now, depending on the state you work in, to be in a trauma role, you may have to be acute care certified. Like I think Jen alluded to that in her presentation. However, in Washington, D.C., you didn't have to be. So I think my former colleague Liz, is still primary care certified and was able to function in her role. So having the acute care versus the primary care totally depends on the jurisdiction of your board of nursing. But with that, I would say that having the acute care training would be really helpful. Now, you're already a trauma program manager, so you understand probably the depth of the role and the knowledge required, but I would definitely pursue that if that is the acute care certification, if that is something that you're wanting to, where you want to ultimately end up. Did that answer your question?
It does. It does. Yeah. I'm an ED nurse and PICU nurse by trade for an umpteen number of years that I won't. But yeah, so I've had a lot of experience from that end as an RN, but I don't know. I've looked into a couple ideas of a DNP / acute care certificate program, like all in one. And I don't know if that would be worth it to just go ahead and jump in with both feet and do all of it after this primary care or what I should do. But yeah, it's kind of interesting to kind of look at both ends if you're looking at this part of being a nurse practitioner for sure.
Well, I would practice.
Go ahead.
Oh, go ahead.
I was just going to definitely look at wherever you want to practice, what the state rules. I know Texas and Arkansas, you have to be acute care to work in certain areas.
And I just saw a comment, I think, from our colleague, Rochelle, in Colorado, you also have to be acute care certified to be hired. So I don't know. You said you're at Dartmouth, so you're in New Hampshire?
Correct.
Yeah, you would have to look into the, I'm unfamiliar with New Hampshire's laws. But I went back and got my acute care certification as part of my DMP. I had been an NP for almost 10 years before.
Awesome.
I got my acute care certification. Brandy,
if that's okay. That's
absolutely. Yeah. I'll put my email in the chat.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I know there was a question also in the chat regarding additional certificates or trainings for PAs. So I can start with that one. And then Kelly, you know, you obviously have a lot of experience with additional fellowship training as a PA. But I will say that, you know, on graduation, I was fairly particular about what areas of medicine I wanted to practice in. So in that was a bit selective in what I applied for. But for orthopedic surgery, I did not need anything additional. Transitioning from orthopedic surgery to pediatric general surgery trauma, you know, of course, they do want you to be PAL certified. They do want you to have ATLS. Those are parts, requirements of the job. However, I will say that in my circumstance, and also as a hiring manager, you know, it's great if a candidate already comes with those things, but really if I am expecting people to onboard with those already in place, you know, that's a little bit unfair. So I hire for the best mutual fit based on experience, based on potential, and that, you know, that best fit. And so those are things that I'm willing to invest as the employer or as the hiring manager to make sure that the APPs on my team are meeting those qualifications. So definitely not mandatory. I think also for PAs, specifically residencies and fellowships are becoming more popularized. We've had a lot of interest to PTS in just exploring this practice in general. So I think we'll have good discussion at this year's conference on that topic. Again, not required, but I would say the that if you have the opportunity to fellowship and you do know what specialty you want to commit to, that is favorable in terms of job preference. Kelly, I'll let you speak more to that experience.
Yeah, I think so. Madison, I saw that you said you work in the ER. So I think I agree with Katie. You know, ACS has requirements for the trauma providers, right? You have to have PALS, ATLs, those sorts of things. But I don't think that that necessarily is worth you paying your own hundreds of dollars when a facility should cover that for you. So I wouldn't put as much weight in those sorts of things. I think things such as, you know, taking more engaging roles in your current position, right? Volunteering to be on a QI committee or the trauma committee, or, you know, if this is something that you're interested in, or if it's a surgical subspecialty, right? Like, let's say you're really interested in neuro or orthopedics, trying to get additional knowledge and sort of those roles and those specialties, I would say, although I'm not speaking from the hiring manager perspective, to me, that would be something that would be more beneficial for you and make you stand out in showing your interest. You know, attending conferences and those sorts of things. For example, like there are, speaking like for orthopedics, there are lots of more hands-on type lecture series. I know AAPA has like a musculoskeletal galaxy thing, which is a lot more like hands-on type things. And so looking more at those types of opportunities or involvement, I think would be probably a bigger bang for your buck, if you will. No problem.
I want to be mindful of people's time. Lisa, do you have any insight or additional information, or Johanna, or if Katie is also on the line, Katie Pelton? Would give you guys the remaining minute or so. And then I encourage everyone on the call to reach out directly with questions or areas of interest.
Hi, this is Lisa. Hi, I'm the president of the Pediatric Trauma Society. No, I'm just so proud of everybody who's on this group and the work that you guys did to pull this together. And if there's ever any questions and stuff related to the PTS, let us know. That's really what we're here for. I work not only as the president for PTS, I'm also the liaison to this committee to make sure that whatever needs that the nurse practitioners and stuff have for the committee itself are taken back to the board. So I greatly appreciate this opportunity and stuff to actually have this education today. So thank you guys.
Awesome. Johanna, anything? Ah, perfect. There's that magical slide that talks about membership and the benefits. So we'll leave this up for a minute or so, but to Morgan's question in the chat about current students, anyone hiring or know of any positions, that is also a benefit of joining our network, is that we do post opportunities. Hiring, word of mouth gets around, endless opportunities to learn about what's available through the network. Anyone else? Closing comments? Okay. Well, thank you everyone for joining. I hope this has been really helpful and informative. Please reach out if you have questions or ideas. We really want to foster our network and learn more from you about what are your needs in this space. And we have a lot of really enthusiastic colleagues who are here to help. So thank you everyone. And thanks Kelly and Jen for presenting. That was outstanding.
Thanks for coming everyone.
Yeah, thanks for joining.
Jen, did you see someone wanted your email in the chat?
Oh yeah, here, sorry.
Great job, ladies.
Thanks, Brandy. You.
Yeah,
thanks for speaking
up. I think this was super helpful. Yeah, no.